Hello everyone, this is Ronita Jana. I'm a fifth year PhD student at Raman Research Institute in India. At present, I'm writing my thesis and also searching for postdoctoral positions to continue my research work. During the last 4 years, I'm working on the interaction between galaxy and their surroundings, mainly focusing on the cosmic rays. So what do I mean by the surroundings? I mean the diffuse gaseous medium both inside and around the galaxy. That is, the circumgalactic medium and the intergalactic medium. Galaxies continuously interact with CGM and IGM in a number of ways. Through the gravitational potential well, they accrete matter from the surrounding. They also interact through stellar radiation and gaseous outflow triggered by star formation and supernova explosions. They also interact through the high energy particles or cosmic rays. Now, I'll briefly discuss the key results of my work based on these 4 papers. These works have been done with my supervisor, Biman Nath. I also collaborated with Professor Peter Bierman, Dr. Siddharth Gupta, and Manami Roy for some of these papers. In my first paper, I studied the cosmic ray heating of intergalactic medium around high redshift galaxies. This is a plot of energy decay rate of cosmic ray protons as a function of their energy if they interact with the IGM through Coulomb interaction. The decay rates are slightly different depending on whether the IGM gas is ionized or neutral. Now, in this process, the cosmic ray protons transfer their kinetic energy to the IGM and IGM gets heated. We studied a number of systems like galaxies with continuous star formation as well as galaxies with starburst episodes. Here I present a particular case of population 3 supernova explosion in a high redshift mini halo. These halos have mass in the range of 10 to the power 6 to 7 solar mass. It is believed that the first stars or the population 3 stars appeared in such mini halos around redshift of 20, and due to their massive size, they exploded in powerful supernova explosions within a few millennia. The energy emitted in such a supernova explosion is in the range of 10 to the power 52 to 53 arc, which is at least an order of magnitude higher than the binding energy of such a halo. So, only one such supernova is capable to disrupt the host halo. The same system was studied by Sazonov and Soniev in 2015. They were interested in finding the mean temperature increase of the universe for such explosions at high redshift. They also discussed its possible impact on the global 21 centimeter radiation. Our motivation was to find the temperature profile of the heated gas around such a mini halo. To find if the heating is uniform or patchy around the halos. Using a power law spectrum, we calculated the temperature profile, and the green and blue curve here shows the temperature profile around such a mini halo at redshift of 10, depending upon the supernova energy. The green and blue horizontal lines here show the estimate by Sazonov. We decided to call the heating homogeneous if the global mean temperature increase estimated by Sazonov crosses our local temperature average within the interhalo distance. In that way, we put an upper limit on the diffusion coefficient for the heating to be inhomogeneous. We found that the limiting value of the diffusion coefficient is in the order of 10 to the power 26 centimeters squared per second for the redshift range of 10 to 20. Another important result of this paper is that the cosmic ray heating around massive galaxies can be to such an extent that the thermal velocity of the heated gas can exceed the infall velocity. In that case, the infall gets suppressed, and as a result, the cosmic ray heating acts as a negative feedback to the star formation of the galaxy. Next, I studied the radio background produced by the cosmic rays accelerated in population 3 supernovae. While we were working on the cosmic ray heating problem, AGES reported the first detection of 21 centimeter radiation from the beginning of epoch of reionization. The absorption trough was centered at 78 megahertz, that is at redshift of 17, and the best fitted profile had an amplitude of 0.5 Kelvin, which is almost twice the expected depth from the theoretical models. The shape of the absorption trough with its short edges was also difficult to understand in the context of the standard models. Following the detection, numerous efforts have been made to understand the depth of the absorption trough. Instead of invoking any exotic physics, we decided to check if the background radiation created by the Population 3 supernova explosions, which is an inevitable event in the high redshift, can explain the trough. Cosmic ray electrons accelerated in those explosion sites interact with the IGM magnetic field and emit synchrotron radiation in the radio band. This excess radio background can increase the depth of the absorption trough. This plot here shows that if the magnetic field gets amplified by 50 times around the shock waves produced in such explosions, then the corresponding radio flux can actually explain the 0.5K absorption trough. The amplification factor 50 is a reasonable number. In diffusive shock acceleration simulations, it has been shown that the amplification factor can be as high as 100. But there is a second part of this story. Cosmic ray protons produced at the same time interact with the intergalactic medium and lose a large fraction of their energy through Coulomb interaction. Thus, the IGM gets heated, which in turn decreases the absorption trough. So, there are two competing processes. The production of radio background by cosmic ray electrons increases the depth of the trough, and the heating of IGM by cosmic ray protons decreases the depth of the trough. The trade-off between these two effects is such that the absorption trough cannot be greater than 0.25 Kelvin. Next, we investigated the role of cosmic rays in the early stage of galactic outflows. The outflow is an important aspect of galactic evolution. They regulate the star formation in the galaxy, as well as they play an important role in the metal enrichment of the IGM. But it is not very clear what actually drives the outflows. The thermal pressure due to shock heating of ISM gas by supernovae and stellar winds has been studied as the main driving mechanism. But recently, the non-thermal pressure components like radiation pressure and cosmic ray pressure are also being studied. We wanted to study the relative importance of thermal pressure and cosmic ray pressure in driving the galactic scale outflowing gas. We performed a very simple idealized simulation. We had a disk of 10 to the power 4 Kelvin gas surrounded by a hot halo gas with temperature equal to the virial temperature of the halo. The fiducial case was for a galaxy with virial mass 10 to the power 11 solar mass. The density and temperature profile of the initial setup is shown in the plot at the bottom right corner of this slide. We injected thermal energy corresponding to the star formation rate in the central region, and wherever a shock is detected, the total pressure was redistributed between the thermal and cosmic ray component depending upon this ratio W. After running the simulation for 20 million years, let us look at the density and temperature distribution. In the left panel, we show the purely thermally driven case, and the right panel here shows the density distribution when the outflow is driven by both thermal and cosmic ray pressure. By comparing the outermost shock position in these two cases, we can say that there is no significant difference. The bubble is slightly smaller when cosmic ray is included, which actually supports the previous analytical studies by Chevalier. We also notice that the temperature of the outflowing gas is slightly lower in case of cosmic ray driven outflow. Now, a slightly smaller bubble in presence of cosmic rays may be due to a number of reasons. The effective adiabatic index decreases from 5/3 when the outflow is partly driven by cosmic ray pressure. Moreover, the cosmic rays diffusing out of the bubble carry a significant amount of energy. Even the excess cooling of outflowing gas can decrease the size of the bubble in presence of cosmic rays. We also plotted mass loading factor for all our simulations. The plot here does not show any significant difference in mass loading depending on whether the outflow is driven by thermal pressure or cosmic ray pressure. While doing this exercise, I noticed that there is a pattern in the simulation results depending on the way star formation rate is implemented in the setup. Those who have used star formation rate coupled with the feedback found that the efficiency of feedback increases in presence of cosmic rays, which is depicted by an increase in mass loading and decrease in star formation rate. But those who have used time-independent star formation rate, like us, found no significant difference. So, next I extended our simulation up to 210 million years with periodic star formation rate. Like for first 30 million years, we keep the star formation on, and then in the next 30 million year we keep it off, and then again in the next 30 million year we keep it on like that. This is the density distribution at around 150 million year. If we zoom in, we can see that there is a few cold clumps when the outflow is purely thermally driven. But in presence of cosmic rays, they are completely absent. Our guess is that cosmic ray-induced thermal instability suppresses the cold cloud formation. A similar result has been found by Bursky et al. In their recent paper. So, if the cold clumps do not form and the gas remains suspended in the CGM instead of raining down on the disk, it will help to suppress the star formation rate even more. So, if we want to summarize the result in one sentence, it would be, inclusion of cosmic ray pressure does not change the outflow dynamic significantly in the early stage of evolution, though the morphology and temperature of the outflowing gas changes. The next question we were interested in was, how much cosmic rays are there in the Milky Way circumgalactic medium? Based on this work, we have submitted a 4-minute video in the new results section. If you have already watched that, you can skip the rest of this video. So, recent numerical simulations of galactic outflows have shown that the CGM can be significantly populated with cosmic rays. According to these simulations, the ratio of cosmic ray pressure to thermal pressure eta can vary widely, ranging from 1 to even 100 for different transport mechanisms. We tried to constrain the cosmic ray population with the help of gamma ray and radio observations. Cosmic ray protons interact with CGM protons and produce neutral pions. These neutral pions immediately decay into gamma ray photons. On the other hand, cosmic ray electrons interacting with the CGM magnetic field produce synchrotron emission in radio band. We used formula data for the gamma ray photons and the RK2 balloon borne radio observation data to constrain the cosmic ray population. To calculate the gamma ray and radio flux, we need the density and temperature profiles. There are two widely studied analytical models for the CGM. With dotted line in the left panel, we show the isothermal model where the CGM temperature is held constant. And in the right panel, the precipitation model where the density and temperature profiles are modeled depending on the ratio of cooling time to freefall time. We modified these two models to include the non-thermal cosmic ray component, taking eta as a parameter. The solid lines here show the profiles with different values of eta. It turns out that the modified models satisfy the density and temperature constraints from the observations. Using these density and temperature profiles, we calculated the radio and gamma ray flux. Radio synchrotron flux does not constrain the isothermal model, but puts an upper limit of eta less than equal to 400 for the precipitation model. Then we calculated the gamma ray flux at a particular frequency. The figure here shows that the isotropic gamma ray background flux puts an upper limit of eta less than equal to 3 for the isothermal model and eta less than equal to 230 for the precipitation model. But the off-center position of the solar system in the Milky Way gives rise to an anisotropy in the gamma ray flux. The anisotropy, when compared to the observed value, says that eta should be greater than 100 for the precipitation model, and it rules out any cosmic ray population for the isothermal model. This was a really interesting exercise, and I'd like to check the outflow and CGM simulations in the light of these constraints. So that's all. If you have watched the video so far, thank you so much for your patience. All these papers are available in archive. Please let me know if you have any suggestions or feedback. I'm available in the KITP Slack channel, and my email ID is Ronita, RANITA, Ronita@RRI.res.in. Thank you.